Chapter 2. Byplay. A right splendid old dowager was Lady Treherne, in her black velvet and point lace, as she sat erect and stately on a couch by the drawing-room fire, a couch which no one dare occupy in her absence, or share uninvited. The gentlemen were still over their wine, and the three ladies were alone. My lady never dozed in public, Mrs. Snowdon never gossiped, and Octavia never troubled herself to entertain any guests but those of her own age, so long pauses fell, and conversation languished, till Mrs. Snowdon roamed away into the library. As she disappeared, Lady Treherne beckoned to her daughter, who was idly making chords at the grand piano. Seating herself on the ottoman at her mother's feet, the girl took the still handsome hand in her own and amused herself with examining the old-fashioned jewels that covered it, a pretext for occupying her telltale eyes, as she suspected what was coming. "My dear, I'm not pleased with you, and I tell you so at once, that you may amend your fault," began Madame Mire in a tender tone, for though a haughty, imperious woman, she idolized her children.
"What have I done, Mama?" asked the girl.
"Say rather, what have you left undone? You have been very rude to Mr. Annan. It must not occur again, not only because he is a guest, but because he is your brother's friend." My lady hesitated over the word lover, and changed it, for to her Octavia still seemed a child, and though anxious for the alliance, she forbore to speak openly, lest the girl should turn willful, as she inherited her mother's high spirit.
"I'm sorry, Mama. But how can I help it, when he teases me so that I detest him?" said Octavia, petulantly.
"How tease, my love? Why, he follows me about like a dog, puts on a sentimental look when I appear, blushes, and beams, and bows at everything I say, if I am polite, frowns and sighs if I'm not, and glowers tragically at every man I speak to, even poor Morris. Oh, Mama, what foolish creatures men are!" And the girl laughed blithely, as she looked up for the first time into her mother's face. My lady smiled, as she stroked the bright head at her knee, but asked quickly, "Why say even poor Morris, as if it were impossible for anyone to be jealous of him?"
"But isn't it, Mama? I thought strong, well, men regarded him as one set apart and done with, since his sad misfortune."
"Not entirely. While women pity and pet the poor fellow, his comrades will be jealous, absurd as it is. No one pets him but me, and I have a right to do it, for he is my cousin," said the girl, feeling a touch of jealousy herself. "Rose and Blanche Talbot outdo you, my dear, and there is no cousinship to excuse them."
"Then let Frank Annan be jealous of them, and leave me in peace. They promised to come today. I'm afraid something has happened to prevent them." And Octavia gladly seized upon the new subject. But my lady was not to be eluded. "They said they could not come till after dinner. They will soon arrive. Before they do so, I must say a few words, Tavia, and I beg you to give heed to them. I desire you to be courteous and amiable to Mr. Annan, and before strangers to be less attentive and affectionate to Morris. You mean it kindly, but it looks ill, and causes disagreeable remarks. Who blames me for being devoted to my cousin? Can I ever do enough to repay him for his devotion? Mama, you forget he saved your son's life." Indignant tears filled the girl's eyes, and she spoke passionately, forgetting that Mrs. Snowdon was within earshot of her raised voice. With a frown, my lady laid her hand on her daughter's lips, saying coldly, "I do not forget, and I religiously discharge my every obligation by every care and comfort it is in my power to bestow. You are young, romantic, and tender-hearted. You think you must give your time and health, must sacrifice your future happiness to this duty. You are wrong, and unless you learn wisdom in season, you will find that you have done harm, not good." "God forbid! How can I do that? Tell me, and I will be wise in time."
Turning the earnest face up to her own, Lady Treherne whispered anxiously, "Has Morris ever looked or hinted anything of love during this year he has been with us, and you his constant companion?"
"Never, Mama, he is too honorable and too unhappy to speak or think of that. I am his little nurse, sister, and friend, no more, nor ever shall be. Do not suspect us, or put such fears into my mind, else all our comfort will be spoiled." Flushed and eager was the girl, but her clear eyes betrayed no tender confusion as she spoke, and all her thought seemed to be to clear her cousin from the charge of loving her too well. Lady Treherne looked relieved, paused a moment, then said, seriously but gently, "This is well, but, child, I charge you tell me at once, if ever he forgets himself, for this thing cannot be. Once I hoped it might, now it is impossible. Remember that he continue a friend and cousin, nothing more. I warn you in time, but if you neglect the warning, Morris must go. No more of this, recollect my wish regarding Mr. Annan, and let your cousin amuse himself without you in public." "Mama, do you wish me to like Frank Annan?" The abrupt question rather disturbed my lady, but knowing her daughter's frank, impetuous nature, she felt somewhat relieved by this candor, and answered decidedly, "I do. He is your equal in all respects, he loves you, Jasper desires it, I approve, and you, being heart whole, can have no just objection to the alliance." "Has he spoken to you?" "No, to your brother." "You wish this much, Mama?" "Very much, my child." "I will try to please you, then." And stifling a sigh, the girl kissed her mother with unwonted meekness in tone and manner. "Now I am well pleased. Be happy, my love. No one will urge or distress you. Let matters take their course, and if this hope of ours can be fulfilled, I shall be relieved of the chief care of my life." A sound of girlish voices here broke on their ears, and springing up, Octavia hurried to meet her friends, exclaiming joyfully, "They have come! They have come!" Two smiling, blooming girls met her at the door, and, being at an enthusiastic age, they gushed in girlish fashion for several minutes, making a pretty group as they stood in each other's arms, all talking at once, with frequent kisses and little bursts of laughter, as vents for their emotion. Madame Mir welcomed them and then went to join Mrs. Snowdon, leaving the trio to gossip unrestrained. "My dearest creature, I thought we never should get here, for Papa had a tiresome dinner party, and we were obliged to stay, you know," cried Rose, the lively sister, shaking out the pretty dress and glancing at herself in the mirror as she fluttered about the room like a butterfly. "We were dying to come, and so charmed when you asked us, for we haven't seen you this age, darling," added Blanche, the pensive one, smoothing her blonde curls after a fresh embrace. "I'm sorry the Ulsters couldn't come to keep Christmas with us, for we have no gentleman but Jasper, Frank Annan, and the Major. Sad, isn't it?" said Octavia, with a look of despair, which caused a fresh peal of laughter. "One apiece, my dear, it might be worse." And Rose privately decided to appropriate Sir Jasper. "Where is your cousin?" asked Blanche, with a sigh of sentimental interest. "He is here, of course. I forget him, but he is not on the flirting list, you know. We must amuse him, and not expect him to amuse us, though really, all the capital suggestions and plans for merrymaking always come from him." "He is better, I hope?" asked both sisters with real sympathy, making their young faces womanly and sweet. "Yes, and has hopes of entire recovery. At least, they tell him so, though Dr. Ashley said there was no chance of it." "Dear, dear, how sad! Shall we see him, Tavia?" "Certainly, he is able to be with us now in the evening, and enjoys society as much as ever. But please take no notice of his infirmity, and make no inquiries beyond the usual how do you do. He is sensitive, and hates to be considered an invalid more than ever. How charming it must be to take care of him, he is so accomplished and delightful." "I quite envy you," said Blanche pensively. "Sir Jasper told us that the General and Mrs. Snowdon were coming. I hope they will, for I've a most intense curiosity to see her," began Rose. "Hush, she is here with Mama. Why curious? What is the mystery? For you look as if there was one," questioned Octavia under her breath. The three charming heads bent toward one another as Rose replied in a whisper, "If I knew, I shouldn't be inquisitive." There was a rumor that she married the old general in a fit of pique, and now repents. I asked Mama once, but she said such matters were not for young girls to hear, and not a word more would she say. Nimport, I have wits of my own, and I can satisfy myself. The gentlemen are coming. Am I all right, dear? And the three glanced at one another with a swift scrutiny that nothing could escape, then grouped themselves prettily, and waited, with a little flutter of expectation in each young heart. In came the gentlemen, and instantly a new atmosphere seemed to pervade the drawing room, for with the first words uttered, several romances began. Sir Jasper was taken possession of by Rose. Blanche intended to devote herself to Maurice Treherne, but Anne intercepted her, and Octavia was spared any effort at politeness by this unexpected move on the part of her lover. "He is angry, and wishes to pique me by devoting himself to Blanche. I wish he would, with all my heart, and leave me in peace. Poor Maurice, he expects me, and I long to go to him, but must obey Mama." And Octavia went to join the group formed by my lady, Mrs. Snowdon, the general, and the major. The two young couples flirted in different parts of the room, and Treherne sat alone, watching them all with eyes that pierced below the surface, reading the hidden wishes, hopes, and fears that ruled them. A singular expression sat on his face as he turned from Octavia's clear countenance to Mrs. Snowdon's gloomy one. He leaned his head upon his hand and fell into deep thought, for he was passing through one of those fateful moments which come to us all, and which may make or mar a life. Such moments come when least looked for: an unexpected meeting, a peculiar mood, some trivial circumstance, or careless word produces it, and often it is gone before we realize its presence, leaving after effects to show us what we have gained or lost. Treherne was conscious that the present hour, and the acts that filled it, possessed unusual interest, and would exert an unusual influence on his life. Before him was the good and evil genius of his nature in the guise of those two women. Edith Snowdon had already tried her power, and accident only had saved him. Octavia, all unconscious as she was, never failed to rouse and stimulate the noblest attributes of mind and heart. A year spent in her society had done much for him, and he loved her with a strange mingling of passion, reverence, and gratitude. He knew why Edith Snowdon came, he felt that the old fascination had not lost its charm, and though fear was unknown to him, he was ill-pleased at the sight of the beautiful, dangerous woman. On the other hand, he saw that Lady Treherne desired her daughter to shun him and smile on Anne. He acknowledged that he had no right to win the young creature, crippled and poor as he was, and a pang of jealous pain wrung his heart as he watched her. Then a sense of power came to him, for helpless, poor, and seemingly an object of pity, he yet felt that he held the honor, peace, and happiness of nearly every person present in his hands. It was a strong temptation to this man, so full of repressed passion and power, so set apart and shut out from the more stirring duties and pleasures of life. A few words from his lips, and the pity all felt for him would be turned to fear, respect, and admiration. Why not utter them, and enjoy all that was possible? He owed the Trehernes nothing. Why suffer injustice, dependence, and the compassion that wounds a proud man deepest? Wealth, love, pleasure might be his with a breath. Why not secure them now? His pale face flushed, his eye kindled, and his thin hand lay clenched like a vice as these thoughts passed rapidly through his mind. A look, a word at that moment would sway him, he felt it, and leaned forward, waiting in secret suspense for the glance, the speech which should decide him for good or ill. Who shall say what subtle instinct caused Octavia to turn and smile at him with a wistful, friendly look that warmed his heart? He met it with an answering glance, which thrilled her strangely, for love, gratitude, and some mysterious intelligence met and mingled in the brilliant yet soft expression which swiftly shone and faded in her face. What it was she could not tell, she only felt that it filled her with an indescribable emotion never experienced before. In an instant it all passed, Lady Treherne spoke to her, and Blanche Talbot addressed Morris, wondering, as she did so, if the enchanting smile he wore was meant for her. "Mr. Annan having mercifully set me free, I came to try to cheer your solitude, but you look as if solitude made you happier than society does the rest of us," she said without her usual affectation, for his manner impressed her. "You are very kind and very welcome. I do find pleasures to beguile my loneliness, which gayer people would not enjoy, and it is well that I can, else I should turn morose and tyrannical, and doom some unfortunate to entertain me all day long," he answered with a gentle courtesy which was his chief attraction to womankind. "Pray tell me some of your devices. I'm often alone in spirit, if not so in the flesh, for Rose, though a dear girl, is not congenial, and I find no kindred soul." A humorous glimmer came to Treherne's eyes, as the sentimental damsel beamed a soft sigh and drooped her long lashes effectively. Ignoring the topic of kindred souls, he answered coldly, "My favorite amusement is studying the people around me. It may be rude, but tied to my corner, I cannot help watching the figures around me, and discovering their little plots and plans. I'm getting very expert, and really surprise myself sometimes by the depth of my researches." "I can believe it, your eyes look as if they possessed that gift. Pray don't study me." And the girl shrank away with an air of genuine alarm. Treherne smiled involuntarily, for he had read the secret of that shallow heart long ago, and was too generous to use the knowledge, however flattering it might be to him. In a reassuring tone he said, turning away the keen eyes she feared, "I give you my word I never will, charming as it might be to study the white pages of a maidenly heart. I find plenty of others to read, so rest tranquil, Miss Blanche." "Who interests you most just now?" asked the girl, coloring with pleasure at his words. "Mrs. Snowdon looks like one who has a romance to be read, if you have the skill." "I have read it. My lady is my study just now. I thought I knew her well, but of late she puzzles me. Human minds are more full of mysteries than any written book and more changeable than the cloud shapes in the air." "A fine old lady, but I fear her so intensely I should never dare to try to read her, as you say." Blanche looked toward the object of discussion as she spoke, and added, "Poor Tavia, how forlorn she seems. Let me ask her to join us, may I?" "With all my heart," was the quick reply. Blanche glided away but did not return, for my lady kept her as well as her daughter. "That test satisfies me. Well, I submit for a time, but I think I can conquer my aunt yet." And with a patient sigh Treherne turned to observe Mrs. Snowdon. She now stood by the fire talking with Sir Jasper, a handsome, reckless, generous-hearted young gentleman, who very plainly showed his great admiration for the lady. When he came, she suddenly woke up from her listless mood and became as brilliantly gay as she had been unmistakably melancholy before. As she chatted, she absently pushed to and fro a small antique urn of bronze on the chimney piece, and in doing so she more than once gave Treherne a quick, significant glance, which he answered at last by a somewhat haughty nod. Then, as if satisfied, she ceased toying with the ornament and became absorbed in Sir Jasper's gallant badinage. The instant her son approached Mrs. Snowdon, Madame Mir grew anxious, and leaving Octavia to her friends and lover, she watched Jasper. But her surveillance availed little, for she could neither see nor hear anything amiss, yet could not rid herself of the feeling that some mutual understanding existed between them. When the party broke up for the night, she lingered till all were gone but her son and nephew. "Well, Madame Mamere, what troubles you?" asked Sir Jasper, as she looked anxiously into his face before bestowing her goodnight kiss. "I cannot tell, yet I feel ill at ease. Remember, my son, that you are the pride of my heart, and any sin or shame of yours would kill me. Good night, Morris." And with a stately bow she swept away. Lounging with both elbows on the low chimney piece, Sir Jasper smiled at his mother's fears, and said to his cousin, the instant they were alone, "She is worried about E.S. Odd, isn't it? What instinctive antipathies women take to one another. Why did you ask us here? Demanded Treherne. My dear fellow, how could I help it? My mother wanted the general, my father's friend, and of course his wife must be asked also. I couldn't tell my mother that the lady had been a most errant coquette, to put it mildly, and had married the old man in a pet, because my cousin and I declined to be ruined by her. You could have told her what mischief she makes wherever she goes, and for Octavia's sake have deferred the general's visit for a time. I warn you, Jasper, harm will come of it. To whom, you or me? To both, perhaps, certainly to you. She was disappointed once when she lost us both by wavering between your title and my supposed fortune. She is miserable with the old man, and her only hope is in his death, for he is very feeble. You are free, and doubly attractive now, so beware, or she will entangle you before you know it. Thanks, mentor. I've no fear, and shall merely amuse myself for a week, they stay no longer. And with a careless laugh, Sir Jasper strolled away. Much mischief may be done in a week, and this is the beginning of it, muttered Treherne, as he raised himself to look under the bronze vase for the note. It was gone.